Good morning and welcome to Gloria Dei Lutheran Church on this fifth Sunday after Epiphany, this beautiful Sunday morning when we gather together as a community of faith. Even over the internet, we have trust and faith in our God who gathers us together as the body of Christ. A couple of announcements before we begin our worship this day. It is First Fruits Sunday. We are collecting non-perishable food items and money to go to the local food bank. If you have items you'd like to bring by or donations you'd like to give, please bring them by the church office during business hours. We have a drop box out there to put your food in if you'd like, or you can ring the bell and someone will come and collect your food or your donation or your donations. So thank you for that in advance. We will deliver them then next week. Today is a special day. We have our visitation pastor, Pastor Phil Rue, who will be sharing the gospel message with us this day. And we're so thankful for him and his ministry here with us at Gloria Dei. So let's begin. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Everlasting God, God of power and might, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Be present in our worship this day and teach us. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness. That your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It's our favorite time of the morning. It's children's time. And if I was to have a title for my children's message today, it would be Time Outs Aren't Just for Kids. Why do I say this? Because we all need a little rest sometimes. And even Jesus, we read in our gospel that he needs a rest. What's been happening is he has been traveling and he's been healing all sorts of people. We read in our gospel today that he's been healing. They kept bringing all these people to him, and healing and helping people was what he did for so many hours. So the disciples all rested and Jesus went to sleep, and I think he was exhausted by all that work, all that go, 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 go. And we read that he took kind of a little time out. He went away from the group and he found a place to pray, a space to be by himself and to connect with God. Wow, that is pretty amazing. Because we're not built to just go, 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 are we? Do you ever have times when maybe your parent says, okay, you need to just eat something or take a little break or rest, right? Or it's time for bed now. Yeah, sometimes we want to just go, 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 or we think we have to do things and get something done. But we were created, just like Jesus, to have those times to recharge, to replenish, to rest. It's like thinking if you could run around a building, well, you can't just keep doing that, right? Eventually, you're gonna have to hydrate and stop, or your heart will just, I don't know what it will do, but we have to have that pause. That's the same for our life as people together, that we need time to connect and recharge and rest with God, just like Jesus did. It reminds me of, okay, it's like this cup. We need to fill our cups, right? Speaking of hydration, if we pour our cup, well, that's not gonna work, right? We need one that will actually be filled up and that we can refill and fuel our own selves. That wasn't really a magic trick, was it? Just kind of something silly. But all to make the point that everyone, even Jesus, needs a timeout sometimes. And that is perfectly okay and wonderful. So especially as you're home now or going through all sorts of changes and things, just know that if you're starting to feel a little bit or wound up, that everyone needs a timeout and a time to just reconnect, rest, and take a break. You are so special. You're so loved. God loves you so much and holds you and carries you through all of this. Please know that you are very special and that it's okay. Everything's okay. And make sure, like Jesus, to take time out to pray and rest. God bless you so much. Jesus loves you. Have a beautiful day.
A reading from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel for this Sunday is found in Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 29. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is why I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God's dearly loved people, grace to you and peace from God, who is our Creator, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Today I'm without robes, and that's intentional for my part. It's a reminder to me, at least, and hopefully to you, that most of Jesus' ministry was outside of the synagogue, inside homes, on the streets, and on the dusty roads of the countryside. So with that reminder that a lot of ministry takes place outside of these walls, we're reminded today of what Sunday it is. It's Super Bowl Sunday. Most of you perhaps know that. And one thing, it's not a religious holiday in any by any means, but it's probably a sport and a game that's approached almost with religious zeal. And some people, maybe most, don't watch the game nearly so much as they watch the ads that are coming. And this year, one of the stories of the ads are those who are not advertising anymore. Rather, they're going to give their money that they would have spent on an ad to the vaccine program to help move it along. That's an ad in itself. We rate those ads. We have fun talking about them. But there's one ad that has caught my attention a while back. That was the last time that the Seahawks were in, or at least won, the Super Bowl. That was in 2014. And there was an ad there that I thought was fairly, very interesting, and someone drew it, my attention to it again this week. It featured Derek Coleman. Some of you remember who Derek Coleman was. He was a fullback for the Seahawks who was deaf. In this 1 minute ad, the story is told about Derek, how he became deaf at the age of 3, and how he was bullied and picked on and picked last on his teams as he was a kid growing up. He was harassed, his coaches didn't understand him, and when it came finally to draft day, after he'd been through all of that, he was not drafted. He says in this ad, "Everybody told me to quit, that it was over, but I didn't listen. And now I'm here with lots of fans cheering me on, and I can hear every one of them." And then he walks out into the Super Bowl game. And that scene fades to what the ad is all about: batteries. And the theme of that ad was trust the power within. As Derek had to trust what he knew was gifted to him inside, so everyone is invited to trust the power within, and hopefully the batteries. But when I looked at this these texts for today, I thought that was a pretty good overarching theme for our text. Trust the power that's within you, that's here for you. Live into the power that's here. Isaiah is just a wonderful text. And our verse today, our text today starts out, "Haven't you known? Haven't you seen?" Isaiah is speaking to the people who are captive in Babylon. Life is not easy and good. Everything has been disrupted and difficult, to say the least. Many of them wanted to go home, back to Jerusalem. That was a hope lifted up, and yet many did not want to. They were feeling lost. They were feeling forgotten. They were feeling threatened. "Haven't you known? Haven't you seen?" Isaiah says to them. "The Lord is the everlasting God. The Lord is the creator. And he stretches out the heavens as you look at them." It reminds me of that picture from Apollo 8 of Earthrise, or so many pictures of the Milky Way or the stars out there that just make us feel so small and insignificant. But Isaiah is saying, the Creator God who is here for you, the one who stretched out the heavens, that put all of these here, who knows their names, who reduces princes to nothing, even though they may be repressing you now. This one gives power to the faint. You'll mount up with wings like eagles. You can trust that that power is here for you, even in Babylon. You will return to Jerusalem. Trust and know the power that's here for you. Which brings us to this story in Mark. The power present in the healing presence of Jesus. And it seems that everyone here, that everyone who is sick or oppressed by demons, that when they're brought to Jesus, they're healed. So is this the message in Mark? That Jesus is a healer, and if you only come to Jesus, you will be healed. Perhaps. But I think we need to be careful in this. In our world, as we know it, then and today, there's so much that is not healed. So how do we understand that? We know about COVID, how destructive it's been, and how we've been working and praying that something will be different. We've seen how painful and destructive the way we divide ourselves into races and other groups has been to our society, to our people, to our families even. Distrust is rampant and hurts and destroys. I've lost two friends, two of my high school classmates who died of COVID within the last month and a half, just really days from each other. And in and through this hospitalization of each of them, there were a host of us praying, even as we pray over our prayer list and our friends and our family. We pray that God's healing power will be there. And whenever there were signs of improvement, we would hear from one corner or another, "Praise God, prayer works." But both of them died. We tried to tune into the healing power of Jesus who heals. But, how do we understand this? Why is Jesus healing in the Gospels and not healing when I would love him to heal? I know we cling to our faith and we theorize and we theologize, we spiritualize. But I wonder if the full understanding, the grasping of God's powerful presence among us and for us, isn't somehow caught in this healing story of Peter's mother-in-law. She's in bed with a fever. That's no small thing in that era. It could have destroyed life totally. So I want you to notice the verbs. I want you to see the actions here. Jesus takes her by the hand. He raises her up, a word that suggests there's new strength given to those who are laid low by illness, by unclean spirits, or even death. It's used several times just in the Gospel of Mark, even in chapter 16 of Jesus. It is a word that speaks of recovery, rising up to once again take their place in the world, a reunion again with community, with family. And then again, this mother-in-law, this unnamed human being, serves. The word is the same as what we use for deacon. Get beyond the gender stereotypes here, because she is being restored not to be what we think a woman should do. No, it's not the stereotypes here. She is being restored to those things that give her meaning. She is restored back into her family. She is restored and again a full contributing part of a community. She's the first person in Mark's gospel who exemplifies discipleship. All through the gospel, those disciples whom he called and follow him from here to there, they don't get it yet. But this unnamed woman, Peter's mother-in-law, serves. It's how Jesus, it's the action, it's the word that Jesus uses to describe the essence of his own ministry, to serve rather than to be served. Here we're catching that invitation we first heard in Isaiah. Haven't you known? Haven't you heard? God is healing for you. And it looks like this. The hand of Jesus reaching out, raising up, restoring us to community, to serve. Maybe we look at our world with its divisions and diseases, its imperfections and its ills, and we wonder, where is God in all of this? Will not a change come soon? It's easy to hope as we hold these things, these precious people in prayer that are before us and make us wonder. It is easy to think that somehow God will intervene in some sort of supernatural, magical way and all will be made better. That healing will come from the outside. But more likely God is saying, haven't you known? Haven't you heard? I give you my hand. I raise you up. I put you back into this broken world that you might be my servant. In the midst of all this, trust that power. When you see the needs, I provide for you. Bono, some of you, I'm dating myself now perhaps, that musician who was asked in his day to preach at the National Prayer Breakfast. This is a number of years ago now, obviously. But regarding his expectation of God's presence in the world, he said he was always seeking the Lord's blessing. He told all of these government officials, always asking for blessing on his new song, on his family, on this crazy idea he had. But then a wise man, he said, challenged him to stop. Stop asking God to bless what you're doing. Get involved with what God is doing, because that is already blessed. And he said it changed his life. And as he studied the scriptures, he found that God is with the poor. That, he said, I believe is what God is doing. And he challenged all of those leaders, as I think he still challenges me and us, to live into the gift that God has raised you up to be and to do. Know your power within. Thomas Andrew Dorsey, not Tommy Dorsey, the big band director, but Thomas Andrew Dorsey was a developer and a composer of the early blues and the 20th century gospel music. He was a pianist for Ma Rainey. There's a new movie out about her. But in 1932, his wife Nettie died in childbirth, and his son died 24 hours later. And his grief prompted him to pen the words of that well-known hymn, "Precious Lord, take my hand." And he said, while this song never eclipsed his grief, none of it, he said, was ever soothing to me. From that day to this day, he said. But these words that he penned have captured the hope and the deep desire for all of us to be restored. It's lodged in our hearts, in our helplessness, to receive the hand that is there for us, lifting us up, moving us out into the world. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord. Lead me home. Have you not known? Have you not heard? God's hand reaches out to you, to us, to raise us up in the midst of the fevers of life, so that in these places of great need, we do not need to be overwhelmed, but we're empowered to enter with the healing and serving grace of God. It's good to note that making people well and casting out demons and making sure the job was completely done the way we might, if we think a job has to be complete, or if we think that's what the center of what the healing ministry of Jesus is all about. Just note how Jesus, when he went out to pray and the disciples went searching for him all over and inviting him, telling him, people are waiting for you here, let's go back and finish the job. But he said, let's go on. Let's go on. This work is bigger than this place. It's bigger than one moment in time. I'd be amiss to remind us that we know about that need and that call to move on. We know about this great promise that God raises us up to do ministry, but not always in the same place. Pastor Molly has heard that call now. And as much as we'll miss her presence on our staff, even in our congregation, we know the vision of God's grace is ever on the move. And we bless her as she goes. We give thanks for the healing grace that has come to us through her. We trust the presence that called her to us, that presence remains and takes us by the hand, restoring us to the service and the caring that ever needs God's healing grace in and through this place. It continues, and it goes on with and through her wherever she goes. And we bless her as she goes, even as we continue to receive the hand that lifts us up. So, precious Lord, take my hand. Haven't you known? Haven't you heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. This one does not faint or grow weary. This one gives power to the faint. Those who wait for the Lord, those whose hand is taken by this one, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. God is faithful. Have you not known? Have you not heard? We, this world, this country, those who struggle with the clouds of life, we within this congregation, we're not hidden and forgotten. We're empowered. We're empowered to live God's grace, even in and through the hard, hard, difficult shadows of life. Precious Lord, take my hand. Amen.
Rich and poor, the weak and strong. Guided by the Christ who we proclaim to our neighbors, let us offer our prayers for our church, our world, and all who face a time of great need. For our church and our numerous ministries of outreach, for ministries of feeding, healing, and wholeness, for hospitals, hospice, and long-term care facilities, for Pastor Chris Ode serving in Livingstone's prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God. For your beautiful and mysterious creation, O God, for insects in the grass, clouds in the mountaintops, for all creatures and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all God's amazing creatures on the earth. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For Black History Month, for the gifts, accomplishments, influence, and witness of our African descent neighbors, we stand together with us as partners in the gospel, doing God's work in the world. Though unified as siblings in Christ, we ask God to guide and help each of us in our commitment to socioeconomic equality, racial justice, and reconciliation. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, especially those lacking in supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, for those grieving recent losses of close family and friends, and for all who cry out to you, especially those on our prayer list and those we now name aloud or in our hearts. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For this congregation, comforting from great weariness, whether at work, school, or home, for uncertainty of the future, especially for our youth and young adults, for ministries of companionship and support, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the Holy Spirit's help with listening to each other with respect, to address and heal the political and ideological divisions that discourage us, and keep us from treating one another with love and concern as neighbors and siblings in Christ. For your Spirit's help to unite us and lead us in the work we must do together for the well-being of our communities, nation, and neighbors in need. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Guided by your Holy Spirit, may we be united in love to joyfully accomplish your mission. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, now hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent. For the sake of the one who has redeemed us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please take a moment to share that peace with those around you or say a prayer for peace in this time. We continue now with our offering and offertory music, and just once again, thank you so much for the support and the ministry that you you give to and you do on behalf of Gloria Dei. It really does take all of us together to make up the body of Christ that does the ministry of Christ in this world. Thank you, and let's continue with our offering and offertory music.
O God, receive these our gifts just as you received us. Just as a loving parent receives their child with arms open wide, nourish and encourage us anew in your tender care. And empower us in faithful service so that we may tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen.
As we gather around this table of grace, as you gather around your table at home or wherever you are, know that God is present. Know that Christ is there with you in this holy meal. And so on the night of Jesus' betrayal, we remember that he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, our scripture tells us that Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for them all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so as we receive his true presence in this bread and wine, his true body and blood, let us remember the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Everyone is welcome at the celebration feast. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you for the journey ahead, both this day, now, and forever. Amen.
Christ Jesus, at this your table we have feasted on your very life, and we are strengthened for our journey in this new year. send us forth from this banquet, nourished in body and in spirit to proclaim your good news, and to serve others in your name and through your spirit. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of God, the Creator, Jesus, the Sanctifier, and the Holy Spirit, who sustains all our living. Amen.
To love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.